There are many misconceptions about Polestar and USSR. We will analyze and debunk them all. In this series, we will discuss many topics, such as state of the whole people, peaceful coexistence, the Polestar and USSR economy, the fall of the USSR, and many more topics. So if you are interested in Polestar and USSR, be it as a leftist or just a curious person in general, just lay back and enjoy my video. Debunking Misconceptions about Polestar and USSR, Episode 6, Part 2, Leonid Brezhnev's Economic Reforms. Also, before I start this video, I want to say that this video is technically divided into two or three parts. The first is about the abolishment of the Sovna Rokhoza in 1965 and the Lieberman-Kosygin reforms. This part will try to cover everything from 1966 to 1982. However, if this video won't be short enough to fit in everything, I will just cover the entire rest that won't be covered in this part in a part 3. Before you watch this part, I absolutely advise you to watch part 1 so you understand this part as well. Also, I want to quickly say that we will go in chronological order, or we'll at least try to go in chronological order as much as possible. So we will start with the private garden plot reform of Brezhnev in 1966, and we'll stop at the 1979 Kosygin reforms. Many, like Mao and Hoxha, say that Brezhnev's economic reforms destroy central planning and establish capitalism. Is this true? No, that's wrong, and we will debunk our arguments made by Mao, Hoxha, Descartes, and others against Brezhnev's economic reforms. Before we start part 2, I want to address some things that I didn't talk about in part 1 of my Brezhnev's economic reforms video, because I didn't have enough storage. Let's specifically talk about rewards and competition. Let's start with rewards. Lieberman and Kosygin wanted to reward workers and enterprises based on how well they fulfilled plans, how much wealth they produced, and how effectively they used resources, to quote them. Due to the amount of profit achieved, workers and employees won't only get rewards for high performance during the year, but also a one-time reward at the end of the year. Alexei Kosygin, source Pravda from 1965, number 271. The incentive fund, which was created on the dependence of the achieved level of rentability, shall be the single and only source of all types of rewards. Yevtei Lieberman planned profit and awards. Profits to Lieberman and Kosygin, as I said in part 1, was how much wealth an enterprise produced. So if let's say an enterprise produces on average 9 million rubles a year, but now thanks to a worker it produces 10 million rubles a year, the worker is rewarded. And the amount of wealth produced is largely shown by the incentive fund. Workers and enterprises that also very effectively use resources were rewarded. So if they don't waste much resources and still create very high quality products and in large quantity, they were also rewarded. And like I said in part 1, there were medals and prizes as rewards. So this, for example, was a reward given to workers for working very well, called the Medal for Labor Valor from 1939 to 1991. I'd also like to mention that Lieberman and Kosygin didn't want managers to individually buy means of production, to quote Lieberman. Our profit can't be turned into capital like how nobody individually, not directors, nor labor unions, nor individuals can buy means of production with their bonus. Yevtei Lieberman again on planned profit and awards. Basically, managers couldn't buy means of production with their own money. They had to buy them via the profit fund of the enterprise, which the enterprise controlled, which was controlled by the state, and they couldn't use it for personal use or anything. The state sold tools and resources like machinery to the managers, and the managers bought them. So even after the managers bought tools and resources, they still were under control of the state like machinery. Money and profit couldn't be turned into capital either, which shows that the Lieberman-Kosygin reforms didn't make the USSR capitals. Anyway, let's move on. Was there socialist or capitalist competition in the USSR? In the USSR, there was competition between enterprises over fulfilling the plan as good as possible and creating the best products via the most effective usage of resources, to quote Lieberman and Kosygin. Let the enterprises themselves Having a production program from the center and a long-term standard of rentability show what they are capable of in the competition for the best results. Jefti Lieberman planned profit and awards. It is necessary to direct socialist competition to the rapid introduction of new technology, scientific organization of labor, increase the rentability of production, improve product quality, and increase labor productivity in every possible way. Alexei Kosygin, source, Pravda, from 1965, number 271. Also, I'd like to address that Lieberman and Kosygin are often being misquoted. When they are being misquoted, the context isn't shown. The misquotations can range from just half of a sentence missing from the original quote to not quoting entire paragraphs, which shows the context to these quotes. Often such misquotations look like this, whereas the actual quotes look more like this, which is why if one is extensively interested in this topic, he should always fact-check misquotations like this. Anyway, enough talking, let's start part 2. I'd like to start with the topic of stagnation. This is from a Maoist source that opposes post-down USSR, so take the source with a grain of salt, but regardless, according to it, even in the worst period, in terms of Soviet economic growth after World War II, the economy grew at 3.5%, and that's actually very high. In fact, for decades, most of the developed world's economic growth has been decreasing, and is way worse than the economic growth under Brezhnev and from 1980 to 1985, the worst period in terms of Soviet economic growth after World War II and before Gorbachev. For the past 50 years, the USA's economic growth has been smaller than the one from 1980 to 1985, and it's decreasing more and more. Why is nobody calling this stagnation? Is this stagnation? It's up to you. Or let's look at the USA today in detail. The US economic growth lies at around 2.5%. Why is nobody calling this stagnation? Is this stagnation? It's up to you. Or what about other developed countries? Let's take a look at Europe's economic powerhouse and Europe's economic miracle, Germany, one of the most developed countries in the world in which every immigrant wants to live in. The economy there has been in total growing at less than 1% for the past 10 years. Why is nobody saying that Europe's economic powerhouse is stagnating? Is it stagnating? It's up to you. Or what about France, the developed European economic powerhouse, which keeps the European Union together? For the past 10 years, it has been growing in total at less than 2%. Why is nobody calling this stagnation? Is this stagnation? It's up to you. But if you think that none of these countries are stagnating, then you can't call Brezhnev's USSR the era of stagnation. And in fact, if anything, growth slowing down just shows that the Soviet Union was becoming more and more developed. In fact, underdeveloped and bad countries like in Africa, Central Asia and East Asia usually have high growth rates compared to developed and good countries. Take a look at this map. In fact, Libya, a war-torn nightmare, and Ethiopia, a semi-feudal communal backwater, have the highest growth rates today in the world. I'd also like to address more of its economic the USSR's economic statistics under Brezhnev, which proved that it wasn't stagnating and wasn't a shithole, a claim that many people hold. Let's watch Andrei Fursov.
Если посмотреть на количественные показатели, то это показатели успешного общества. Собственно, в отчетах ЦРУ так и фиксировалось. Давайте запишем. В 1975 году удельный вес Советского Союза в мировой промышленной продукции, как вы думаете, сколько был удельный вес Советского Союза в мировой промышленной продукции в 1975 году? Ну, что у нас сейчас с Российской Федерацией? 20% ВВП, 10% от мирового. 20, это в мировой промышленной продукции. Значит, для сравнения, в 1999 году ВВП США составлял 20,4, записывайте эти цифры, они довольно редкие, просто чтобы самим потом не искать. И если вам будут вешать лапшу на уши, какие были тяжелые проблемы у Советского Союза, вот эти цифры показывают, что дело было не в экономике. Значит, в 75-м году 20% и 10% от мирового валового продукта. Для сравнения, 99-й год США 20,4 мирового ВВП, Евросоюз 19,8. До 1985 года СССР занимал второе место в мире по экономическому развитию и первое место в Европе. Первое место в Европе.
In Europe, the Soviet Union was first in terms of industrial production and second in the world in terms of development. This is not a shithole. And also, I'd like to address that many people say that the Lieberman-Kosygin reforms created stagnation and that this is wrong. In fact, as you can see by looking at this graph, the Lieberman-Kosygin reforms boosted economic growth, and in fact, economic growth slowed down from 1971 to 1973 because they were abolished, which is ironic because Brezhnev originally abolished them because he was scared that they would become inefficient. Also, the Soviet Union got a boost in terms of economic growth from 1973 to 1977 thanks to the oil crisis, which isn't shown on this graph, sadly. Also, I'd like to address that under Khrushchev, economic growth was actually increasing. To quote an article, this period, as well as others, for a full understanding, should be usefully divided into individual periods. That being the period of economic recovery, 1953 to 1958, and the period of slowdown of development, 1959 to 1964. The rise of the rural economy, 1954 to 1958. So, until 1959, under Khrushchev, the economy was basically booming, and he was the one who fully took the Soviet Union out of post-World War II chaos and made it go from a war-torn nightmare to one of the most developed countries in the world. There was a little slowdown from 1959 to 1962, not until 1964, which was both caused by the fact that the USSR was becoming more and more developed and by the Sovnarkhozy, which was an economic experiment that was not revisionist that I covered in episode 5 of my post on USSR series. You see, the Sovnarkhozy were good now and were economically efficient, but planning under Stalin was better, so they were abolished. The abolition was started by Khrushchev, by the way. I'd also like to address that the Soviet Union yet again had a boost in terms of economic growth from 1954 to 1958 in the rural economy. Also, they had a boost from 1962 to 1964. To quote a Soviet document from the Brezhnev era. Over these years, the Soviet economy had made significant progress. Our science has won a number of universally famous victories. The lives of the people have improved. The strength and power of the Soviet state has grown immeasurably, and the political activity of the Soviet people has increased. The authority of the Soviet Union on the international area has further strengthened. All these and other important achievements are the result of a solid execution by the Central Committee of our party of the line of the 20th to 22nd Congresses, both in the field of domestic and foreign policy. Anyway, I know that I haven't talked about a single economic reform in part 2 so far, but I think that this is also worth talking about. Real socialism, also known as developed socialism. In 1967, communism in 20 years was replaced by real socialism, which, if I'm not mistaken, is Suslov's idea, which was later even manifested in the 1977 Constitution of the Soviet Union. So, what is real socialism? To quote the 1977 Constitution of the Soviet Union. A developed socialist society has been achieved in the USSR. At this stage, when socialism is developing on its own basis, the creative forces of the new system and the advantages of the socialist way of life are becoming more fully revealed, and the working people are increasingly enjoying the fruits of the great revolutionary conquests. It is a society in which powerful productive forces have been created, advanced science and culture, which are constantly making the prosperity of the people grow. It is a society in which develop more efficient conditions for the development or for the full development of the individual. This is a society of mature socialist relations. Mature socialist social relations, in which a new historical community of people, the Soviet people, has been formed on the basis of the convergence of all classes and social strata, all legal and de facto equality of all nations and nationalities, and of fraternal cooperation. It is a society of high organizational capacity, ideological commitment, and consciousness of the working people, who are patriots and internationalists. This is a society whose law of life is the concern of all for the good of everyone and the concern of everyone for the good of all. This is a society of genuine democracy, whose political system ensures effective management of all public affairs, an increasingly active participation of workers in public life, and a combination of real rights and freedoms of citizens with their duties and responsibilities to society. A developed socialist society is the natural stage on the road to communism. The 1977 Constitution of the Soviet Union. Okay, so basically real socialism, also known as developed socialism, is just when under socialism there are good living standards, developed productive forces, a developed socialist culture, equality of all nationalities, convergence of all classes and social strata, high motivation of the workers to build socialism and spread Marxism-Leninism. It's also when the principles of democratic centralism and collective leadership are upheld, and it's when more workers participate in the state to help the Marxist-Leninist cause. Is wanting convergence of all classes and all social strata revisionist? No, because class antagonism didn't exist anymore. To quote the 1977 Constitution again, having won the Civil War and repulsed the imperialist intervention, the Soviet government carried out the deepest socio-economic transformations and put an end to the exploitation of men by men, class antagonism and national enmity. The 1977 Constitution of the Soviet Union. Okay, but if class antagonism was abolished, then what classes continue to exist, to quote Brezhnev? Comrades, the October Revolution meant a radical restructuring of the socio-political structure of society. It is here, in this area, that the advantages of socialism over the capitalist organization of social life affected social life for the first time. The exploiting classes have long been eliminated in our country. The unbreakable union of workers, peasants and working intelligentsia is growing stronger and stronger. The Soviet people, closely united around the Communist Party, united by ideological and political unity, is a new community of people unprecedented in history, free from social and national antagonisms. Leonid Brezhnev, following Lenin's course, speeches and articles. Here Brezhnev says that the only remaining classes were the workers and the peasants, and there was the social strata of the intelligentsia. This, in fact, corresponds perfectly with what Stalin and Khrushchev said. Stalin also said that class antagonism was abolished in 1946 and that the only two remaining classes are workers and peasants, to quote him. Unlike bourgeois constitutions, the draft of the new constitution of the Soviet Union proceeds from the fact that there are no longer any antagonistic classes in society, that society consists of two friendly classes, workers and peasants, that it is these classes, the laboring classes, that are in power, that the guidance of society by the state, the dictatorship, is in the hands of the working class, the most advanced class in society, that a constitution is needed for the purpose of consolidating a social order desired by and beneficial to the working people. Joseph Stalin on the draft constitution of the USSR. It means that the exploitation of man by man has been abolished, eliminated, while the socialist ownership of the implements and means of production has been established as the unshakable foundation of our Soviet society. Prolonged applause. As a result of all these changes in the sphere of the national economy of the USSR, we now have a new socialist economy which knows neither crises nor unemployment, which knows neither poverty nor ruin, and which provides our citizens with every opportunity to lead a prosperous and cultured life. Such in the main are the changes of which have taken place in the sphere of our economy during the period from 1924 to 1936. In the conformity with these changes in the economic life of the USSR, the class structure of our society has also changed. Joseph Stalin on the draft constitution of the USSR. For more detail and Khrushchev's quotes on how class antagonism has been abolished and how the only two remaining classes are workers and peasants, watch episode 1 of my post on USSR series. I'll put the link in the description below. Alright, enough for real socialism. Let's now talk about Brezhnev's economic reforms. Let's start with the credit reform of 1967, which was technically part of the Lieberman Kosygin reforms. It centralized credit more, to quote Kosygin. At the same time, it is necessary to limit non-repayable state financing of capital investments and expand the use of credit. Alexei Kosygin, source Pravda from 1965, number 271. One of the ways to solve this problem is to switch from irrevocable allocation of funds for capital construction to long-term lending. It is understood that the credit system will be applied primarily to investments in existing enterprises. As for new construction, it is probably advisable to use a long-term credit system for construction projects that pay for their costs in a relatively short time. Alexei Kosygin, source Pravda from 1965, number 271. In the future, it is proposed to refuse from gratuitous replenishment of working capital of enterprises at the expense of the budget and provide them with temporary loans for this purpose, if necessary. This procedure will encourage enterprises to make a business-like approach to the use of their allocated working capital. Alexei Kosygin, source Pravda from 1965, number 271. In 1964, expenses from the enterprises fund for the introduction of new equipment and the development of production in industry amounted to 120 million rubles. In addition, 600 million rubles were spent on these purposes due to bank loans, and as a whole 720 million rubles. Alexei Kosygin, source Pravda from 1965, number 271. Economic relations between enterprises require strengthening of payment discipline. At the same time, in order to ensure uninterrupted mutual settlements between suppliers and consumers, the role of state credit in economic turnover should be increased. Alexei Kosygin, source Pravda from 1965, number 271. Okay, before we move on, I want to mention that capital in this context is not the same capital as under capitalism. The Soviets defined capital under socialism differently than capital under capitalism, to quote a book from the Brezhnev era from 1980. Capital investment under socialism, the aggregate of expenditures allocated for the creation of new fixed assets and for the modernization and expansion of existing fixed assets, which function both in the production and non-production spheres. Source: a Dictionary of Political Economy by Mikhail Ivanovich Volkov, page 31. So it's not really capital, but just planning, aka investing in material resources like tools. And Kosygin wanted the Gosplan and the state to plan material resources, like he wanted the state and the Gosplan to plan how they will be given to enterprises, for example, and so on. For more detail, watch part one of my Brezhnev's economic reforms episode. I pulled the link, as I said before, to the video in the description down below. Okay, anyway, to summarize Kosygin's quotes, he wanted to expand the use of credit, make the state use loans and credit to plan investments, make the state and bank give temporary loans to enterprises to buy tools and resources, and make the role of state credit increase in economic turnover, aka in giving enterprises credit so it produces the products based on the plan more effectively. Okay, so let's move on to the other reforms in 1967. In 1967 and 1968, the Lieberman-Kosygin reforms were expanded to certain sectors of the economy, that being river transport enterprises, the navy, sovkhozy, which are basically state farms, and other state farms, aviation, railways, operational enterprises, and technical production departments, to quote Wikipedia to show the laws which expanded the Lieberman-Kosygin reforms to these sections of the economy. On the transfer of state farms and other state-owned agricultural enterprises to full khozrasyot, April 13, 1967. On the transfer of enterprises of the Ministry of Civil Aviation to aviation to a new system of planning and economic development incentives from June 7th, 1967, on the transfer of railways of the Ministry of Railways to a new system of planning and economic development incentives from June 23rd, 1967, on the transfer of enterprises of the Ministry of the Navy to a new system of planning and economic development incentives from July 7th, 1967, on the transfer of river transport enterprises of the Union Republics to a new system of planning and economic development incentives July 7th, 1967, on the transfer of operational enterprises and production and technical communication and Communication Department of the Ministry of Communications of the USSR on a new system of planning and economic incentives, July 8, 1968. Some aspects of the Lieberman-Kosygin reforms were implemented as late as 1969 that mostly dealt with planning. Kosygin already talked about them in 1965, though, and Pravda in 1965, number 271, already mentioned them as well. I already covered these aspects in part 1 of my Brezhnev's economic reforms episode, since they were written in Pravda in 1965 already, which is my source for all of Kosygin's quote that I showed, and I don't think that it's necessary to call this a separate reform, as it was in Kosygin's article about the Lieberman-Kosygin reform. Okay, anyway, so now the next thing that I want to talk about is abolishing Orgaz in 1970 and replacing it with Aspir. I think that it's necessary to talk about this, because Brezhnev gets a lot of hate for abolishing Orgaz. Let's first talk about what Orgaz even was and what it implemented in its short history. The Orgaz was an attempt to radically expand the boundaries of the use of the industrial control system and create a single network that does cyber planning. It was never fully implemented, but it managed to make some individual enterprises and car industry be planned via an industrial control system, in an industrial control system being cyber planning. To quote an article, technical support of the automated control system was meaning car industry, had a hierarchical structure of construction and provided a technologically interconnected cycle of registration, collection, processing and issuing information on a daily basis. Anyway, here is the source, and if you want to read more about it, then you can just pause the video. I'd also like to note that the industrial control system, also known as the automated control system, was implemented in individual enterprises as well. This article gives examples, like the one factory in Moscow, dairy plants, and so on, and that even Orgaz was implemented to a very small extent, such as in the electric industry and radio plants, like the Pavlova-Posadsky radio plant. Now let's talk more about the implementation of the industrial control system in individual enterprises, the history of its implementation, about how much it was implemented, where it was implemented, and more. To quote an article, in 1960, for the first time in the USSR, the economic faculty of the Leningrad Polytechnic Institute began training engineers and economists to create and implement automated production management systems. In 1961, the Department of Automation of Production Management was organized. 3 years later, the department created the country's first branch research laboratory for automated production management systems. The development of the theory and practice of creation is largely with the name of the academician Viktor Mikhailovich Gluskov, who had an outstanding role in shaping the ideology of creating automated control systems. He was the first to put forward the idea of creating automated production management systems, ASMS, for enterprises as a low-level automated system for managing the economy as a whole. Political work on the creation of SUP on the basis of domestic universal digital numerators began at the Institute of Cybernetics of the USSR Academy of Sciences in 1963 to 1964. In addition, the Ministry of Communications Industry and the main departments of computer technology, the ministries of industry, interagency coordination councils, and other management bodies were formed to ensure interaction between various structures. It was found necessary to immediately carry out standardization and unification at the state level in the field of development and implementation in order to transfer them to industrial rails. By this time, there was a clear classification of automated control systems by application areas: automated process control system, APC, CS, enterprise or production APCS, and economic sector or ASU. The current oblasts Rostov, Taganrog, Novocherkassk, Krasnodar, and Armavir city committees of the CPSU managed the implementation of SUP quite purposefully. Regional city districts technical and economic councils, TES, councils of the scientific and technical society, NTO, the all-union society of inventors and innovators, VOIR, and other public organizations actively participated in the work. Our research allows us to conclude that the development and implementation of automated control systems at the enterprises of instrumentation and mechanical engineering of the Kuban and Don region in terms of terms, main directions, tools, and methods corresponded to the all-union trend. In the context of broader measures to inform management and scientific and technical activities, it provided significant savings, reduced the management apparatus, and made production more susceptible to the latest achievements in science and technology. In addition, research and design organizations of the Krasnodar territory and the Rostov region have made significant contribution to the spread of SUP within the entire national economic complex of the country. By 1970, there were about 400 automated control systems operating in the country, and 5 years later their number in the civil sector of industry reached 3,000. The main result of this stage was that the usefulness of automated control systems became a generally recognized fact. Basically, the industrial control system already started to be implemented in 1960. In 1961, departments, branch ministries, economic councils, and more for the industrial control system were created, which were all part of the state and helped plan the economy via cyber planning. But it wasn't until 1963 when the implementation truly started, not just as an experiment, but to overall help the economy. It was implemented in process, enterprises, production, and the economic sector on many regions, which also created a lot of regional councils which participated in the planning under state approval. As a result of all this, by 1970, there were about 400 industrial control systems in the country. Basically, 400 state institutions existed that planned the economy via cyber planning in various enterprises, which reached 3,000 by 1975. This was successful and efficient. Now I want to talk about what the industrial control system specifically is, which was implemented in the 1960s and was cyber planning. It's measuring the process of production via cyber planning and input. The received input was then compared to the original planned targets via cyber planning, and finally the industrial control system created commands. through measuring the quantity and speed of production via cyber planning. However, the industrial control system itself didn't plan output and didn't give plans via cyber planning to enterprises. So it wasn't exactly like Orgoth or Aspar. Okay guys, I make my videos on tablet and right now I don't have enough space to talk about ASPR, which was basically Orgoth from 1970 to 1985 under Brezhnev, so I'll just split the cyber planning section of my Brezhnev's economic reforms episode into two parts. Part 2, aka the part that you're watching right now, deals with Orgoth and cyber planning in the 1960s, and part 3 deals with Aspar, aka August after 1970, and cyber planning from 1970 to 1985. In conclusion, real socialism wasn't revisionist and was basically an extension of Stalin's theory of the state of the whole people. Stagnation didn't happen and the USSR's economic growth was way higher even in its worst period of economic growth than the one of the US, France and Germany for the last 5 decades or so. Credit was further centralized and so were loans. The Lieberman-Kosygin reforms were extended more to other sections of the economy throughout the years, and August to a large extent was implemented in the 1960s. Like, share and subscribe if you enjoyed. Stay tuned for part 4.